So, in this course that I'm teaching, so there are going to be three courses in this workshop. I'm going to be teaching this one, and I'm going to try to relate concepts in linear algebra to other topics, particularly related to, in this case, in today's lecture, related to graph theory. And we are going to try, the first thing we are going to try to do is understand the concept of linear independence in sort of what are the axiomatics of this. And one of the sort of big generalizations of linear independence is what is called matroid theory. So, there is a abstract concept of linear independence. Anyway, let me try to explain this in a concrete way, and if you have any questions or doubts, you know, anytime, just please feel free to stop me and ask. And those of you who are online, you can please just type your questions in the chat box. I may not be able to hear you if you say anything. And we have the other TA also for this workshop, Ratish is here. So with that, let's begin. Oh yeah, and also online participants can ask their questions on the forum that has been, you have been subscribed to on Google Groups. Okay, so we are going to start by talking about a simple practical problem. So you have some sort of you have some cities, let's call them A. So I prepared an example here. B, C, D, E, let us throw in two more, F, G. And these cities have some connections by road. So, there are some connections between them. And not all possible connections are there. For example, E is not connected to G, and these roads, just for convenience, we will give them some numbers 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay. 9, 10. Okay, so these are the roads, there are 10 roads. And there's a telecommunication company which needs to lay fiber optic cables to connect all these cities. So, for example, you might lay a cable along this road here, you might lay a cable along here, but then it doesn't make sense to lay a cable here because A and F are already connected via C. So, we want to find some sort of, you know, what are the fewest number of roads along which we want to lay cables. Okay, you will see that somehow this problem will become related to bases of vector spaces. So there are two possible approaches to this problem. Let me just copy this. Okay, maybe I'll add a new page here. Okay, so one way to solve this problem is to start laying cables one by one, and do it in such a way that there is no redundancy. So I might start by laying a cable along the road 1. Okay, so I lay a cable here, and then it is okay to lay a label along 2 because this vertex C is not yet connected to A. And maybe 3 also, there is no harm, right, because F is also not yet connected. Okay, what about 4? Maybe I should not lay a cable along 4 because that will be completely redundant. 5, yes, let us lay a label along cable along 5. And then 6, there is no point because already B is connected to all these. Then 7, well, let us connect 7 because E is not yet connected. 8, do I need to? No, I do not need to connect because D and E are already connected.
Sorry to interrupt, sir.
Yeah.
Sir,
Oh, okay, we will just check that. So it seems the screen is not fully visible online. So it seems to be that multiple people are having this problem. So let me see. Maybe I'll just do a screen share. Okay, I hope it's better now. Huh? Oh, is that right? Now I'm sharing the screen, so it should be okay. Okay, so I hope it's better now. Okay, good. So you see, where were we? We had added 7, and now 8 we did not add, 9 we do not need to add, but 10 we need to add. So, at the end of the day, these are the paths along which we would add cables. So, this I will call the grow approach, because we start with nothing and then we slowly grow the network till we get what we want. Oops. So, I will call this the grow approach. And another way to do this same problem is to start with the whole network and then sort of remove cables which are redundant. So, let us look at this whole network. Will it remain connected if I remove this this cable 1, this it will, right? So, this thing is unnecessary. So, practically you could say let us put cables everywhere and then remove the ones that are not connected. Of course, we do not need to do that in practice, but just as a way of thinking about it, put all the cables and then remove the ones which are not needed. So, this one is not needed, let us see. There should be an option of, oops, how do I, so there is a eraser which is a stroke eraser, yes, huh? No, but I want to make it a stroke eraser, so options, okay, anyway, let us not worry about it. So, I will just erase this whole thing. Okay, so that is gone. What about 2? Is that needed? Not needed, right? Because if I remove 2, I will still have a connection. So, let us remove 2 also. What about 3? Well, if I remove 3, there is a problem, right? A will become isolated. So, let us keep 3. I can remove 4, but because even if I remove 4, C remains connected via B. So, we will remove 4 also. I cannot remove 5, because then C will become disconnected. 6, can I remove? Yes, it looks like I can remove 6. And 7, can I remove? No, because if I remove 7 and then 8, I cannot remove. 9, 10, I cannot remove. So now I come up with another solution to the problem. So we have 2 solutions. One is using the grow approach, and this I'll call the shrink approach. And both give solutions. So in the grow approach, what I did was I kept adding cables until. Making sure that none of the cables I add are redundant, that is, in the second approach I kept removing cables, making sure that each time I remove a cable, the whole network remains connected. So, these were the 2 approaches. So, let us formalize this a little bit, and so what we are talking here is about a graph. So, if you are familiar with a little bit of graph theory, so V and E. So, V is the set of vertices and E is the set of edges. So, in our case the vertices are A, B, C, D, E, what was it? F, G, and E is the set 1, 2 up to 9 I think, or 10. Okay. So, 9, 10. Okay. And this each edge is actually a set of 2 vertices. So, for example, if I just paste that picture again so that we can look at it. So, here you can see that this edge 1 is actually A B, okay, which you can also think of as B A. We are thinking of undirected edges here. So, 2 is what? A C, and we can think of it as C A, but I will just write A C. 3 is A F, and so on. So, this is a graph. A graph is consists of 2 pieces of data. One is a set of vertices and the other is a set of edges, and each edge is an unordered pair of vertices. And what we are looking for is a subset of the set of edges. So, I will call that an edge subgraph. So, so an edge subgraph. So, we have started with this graph V comma E, it is going to be V comma E prime, where E prime is any subset of E. Okay, and these are the only kinds of subgraphs I am going to talk about in this lecture. So, I will just say subgraph, I might not say edge subgraph. So, this is just a subset of the edges, we keep the set of vertices the same. Okay. And what are we looking for? We are looking for, so in our algorithmic problem, what are we looking for? We are looking for an edge subgraph, right? We want to figure out what are the cables that we should lay. So, each cable corresponds to an edge. So, we are looking for an edge subgraph. And what are the properties it must have? It must connect all vertices. What this means is that given any 2 vertices, V and W, there must exist a sequence of vertices V equals V 1, V 2, V k, and the last one is W, such that all these adjacent pairs V 1, V 2, V 2, V 3, V k minus 1, V k are all edges. Okay, and so that was one of the requirements, that our network should cover the entire all the nodes. And the second requirement is it should not have any redundancies, right? There should not be any more cables than are actually needed. So, it must not have any redundancies. So, what would be a redundancy in such a network? So, let us just go up and look at the original network. So, so here a redundancy, suppose we had kept this edge and say this edge and this edge. So, now you see there is some redundancy here, right? What is the meaning of that? That means, yeah. So, if I remove one of these edges, it still remains connected, but what it amounts to is that between 2 vertices there are 2 different paths. So, for example, to go from A to C, I can either go directly using the edge number 2, or I can take a path like going 3, 9, 6, 5. So there are two different paths from A to C, and that is a redundancy. But another way of thinking about a redundancy is, as Daniel here suggested, a cycle. So I can think of, you know, there is one path and I go back along the other path. So, you know, 3, 9, 6, 5, 2 is a cycle. So this 3, 9, 6, 5, 2, this is what is called a cycle. And so that is what we want to avoid in, that is what we want to avoid in the thing. So a cycle, no cycles, or I will actually call this a circuit just for this. And what is a circuit? A circuit is a sequence V1, V2, Vk back to V1 such that all these things are edges, V1, V2, V2, V3. Vk minus 1 Vk, and finally also Vk V1 are all edges. So this is a circuit. So we have two objectives. We have to find an edge subgraph which connects all the vertices in the original graph and which has no circuits. Okay, such an edge subgraph in graph theory is sometimes called as, well, is often called a spanning tree. That is just a technical name, okay, let us not worry too much, but what it means is that it must connect all the vertices and that it must have no circuits. So the objective of our algorithmic problem to start with was that we have a graph and we must find a spanning tree, namely an edge subgraph which connects all the vertices and has no circuits. And we have seen that there are two two different approaches to this. One is to start with no edges and then keep adding edges, and the other is to start with all the edges and keep removing edges which are redundant. So what I claim is that both these approaches will actually give this requirement, namely a spanning tree. So, it is not always true that if you start, you have some objective in mind and you just step by step try to move towards it, you will actually reach that objective. For example, if you are trying to you know, in a city you are trying to go somewhere and you keep taking the path that is going in that direction, you might still end up at a dead end and you may not be able to finish your algorithm. So what we need to say is that both these approaches, the grow approach and the shrink approach, will give a spanning tree at the end. So one claim is that both approaches grow and shrink will give a spanning tree. So let us just think about this. It is nothing difficult, I just want to think it through very carefully. So what we are doing in the grow approach, we are starting with nothing, so there are no circuits, and we are growing as long as there are no circuits. So it is clear that the grow approach will always give no circuits, right. The question is, will it result in something that is connecting everything, right. So grow, we are growing via circuit free subgraphs. So, it is clear that at every stage what we get will be circuit free. What is not clear is that we will end up with something that is spanning, that connects all the vertices. But you know, suppose E prime is circuit free, and we cannot add any edges, any more edges, and keep it circuit free. So, what I will say is maximal circuit free. That means, so suppose E prime is circuit free, and if I try to add any more edges to it, then I get a circuit. Okay, so suppose E prime is maximal circuit free, but adding an edge. So, that means that maximal just means that adding an edge. Adding any more edges will create a circuit. So let's So let's we need to show that this will connect all vertices, right? So suppose we have two vertices in our graph, let's say A and say Z, okay? So, and let's say these are not connected by some path. So what we can do is we can look at all the vertices that are connected to A. So there'll be a bunch of vertices that are connected to A, and that's one group. And we look at all the vertices that are connected to Z, and we will think of that as another group. So, and that is another group. And what we are saying is, okay, A is not connected to Z, then we should be able to add an edge, right? But since A is not connected to Z, oh yeah, so here to start with, of course, we have to assume that the original network we had was itself connected, otherwise there is no way you can do this. So that is an assumption that I should have mentioned, that the original network is connected. So the original network has a path from A to Z, right? So there must be a vertex that is an edge that is starting inside A and going outside A. It might go to Z or it might go somewhere else, because there is a path from A to Z. So at some point there should be an edge that is leaving this. So let's call this part P1, PA, and let's call this part PZ. The part connected to A and the part connected to Z. So there must be an edge going from the part connected to A outside of the path connected to A. But that edge is clearly not in my E prime, right? Because E prime only connects the vertices in A to the vertices in PA. So this edge, this new edge can be added. So this means that if it is not connected, then there is an edge that I can add and still keep. So then I have to check that this is circuit free, but this is of course circuit free because this new vertex that I have here was not originally connected to A. So, there is only one path from A to this vertex, which has to pass through E. So what we have seen here is that when we grow via circuit free subgraphs, when we reach the stage that we cannot add any more new edges, then the resulting graph has to connect all the vertices. And the other thing is the shrink algorithm. So here what we are doing is we are starting with the whole graph which is connected, and we keep removing edges so that it remains connected. And at the end of the day, we want that, you know, after we can remove no more, we want to say that the resulting graph has no cycles, right? So suppose E prime connects all vertices, and no edge. So it is, let us say, E prime can is min, no edge can be removed from V prime, or let me say it maybe in a more simpler English, and removing any edge from E prime results in something that is not connected. And removing any edge from E prime results in a graph that is not connected. Then I want to claim that E prime has no circuits, right? So, I want to say that E prime has no circuits. So, I have all these vertices A, B, C, D and so on, and they are all connected, and suppose there was a circuit in this graph, right. So, suppose that there is a circuit, let us say A, B, C, D, or rather A, C, D, B, right. So, that means that between, so let us just take two points adjacent in this circuit A, B. So, there will be two paths from A to B, either just go directly from A to B or you go A, C, D, B. So, if I were to just remove this edge A, B, then the graph would still remain connected, right. The only problem would be that, you know, there is no way to go from A to B. And so, if the shrink approach also gives rise to a circuit free graph that connects all vertices. So, both these approaches work, one of them grows and the other shrinks. Okay. And this is a way, algorithmic way to construct spanning trees. Now, there is this very remarkable fact that all spanning trees have the same number of edges. Let us see, is this really true? Anything time I say something, you should not believe it, but at least let us look at the examples we have constructed using two different algorithms. So, this was the one that we got, the spanning tree that we got using the GRU algorithm, and how many edges does it have? It has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And let us see, this is the one, what is this? No, not this. This is the one I got using the shrink algorithm, and how many does this have? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Of course, it could just be a coincidence in this case, but it turns out that this is actually always true, and it is not obvious at first glance why this is true. Okay, does this remind you of something in linear algebra? Dimension, right. So, in linear algebra, we talk about the dimension of a vector space, and we say that the dimension of the vector space is the size of a basis, right. And what is a basis? It is a set that firstly spans the entire vector space, and secondly, it is linearly independent. So, this spans the entire vector space is sort of analogous to connecting all the vertices. And linearly independent is analogous to having no cycles. In fact, we will see that this can be made completely precise in a sense that these are exactly, we will see that these are actually the same problem, that special case of the basis problem gives this result. But first, let us try to understand this. Why all spanning trees have the same size, purely using graph theory, and then we will try to understand it using linear algebra. So, if you can try, you know, to find some more spanning trees for this graph that we have in this example, and you will always see that they have six edges. Okay. You could ask, for example, suppose I have so there is a complete graph, which is where every pair of vertices are connected by an edge. So, the complete graph on say 5 vertices looks like this. So, I will have A, B, C, D, E, and I will connect every pair of them by an edge. Oh, no, yeah, that also. No, that is already connected. What am I doing? Yeah, so a beautiful graph. And now let us see, can you find me a spanning tree? So, so maybe we will use, what should we use, shrink or grow? Shrink, okay, shrink, okay. So, I let us just try to start deleting. No, so A B will first delete, that is fine, right? A C, can I delete? Oh, this eraser is not good, okay, and then A D. Yes. And then AE I cannot delete, right? That would cause problems. Okay, so I am done with deleting everything that I can delete from A. Let us move on to B. I can delete BC, I guess. I can delete BD also. Better not to delete BE, right? And then CD I can delete. See, I got this lovely, this is called a claw graph. So, this is just connect E to everything, right? And that is a spanning tree for the complete graph. And how many edges does it have? It has 4 edges. So, you can guess that if I were to take the complete graph on 10 vertices, then a spanning tree would just be take one of them and connect them to the other 9. So, the spanning trees would all have, this spanning tree would have 9 vertices. But what is amazing is that any spanning tree you construct will have 9 vertices. So, for example, I do not have to do it in the systematic way that I did. I have this A, B, C, D, E, and I could just say I will connect A to E. Let us keep this, okay. Then I do not want to connect, I cannot connect A to B, but maybe I can do something else. Oh, that is it, no? So, yeah, so this is a very different looking spanning tree from this, but this also has 4 vertices, right. So, both these have 4 vertices, and that is the sort of strange thing that seems to be happening here, that all spanning trees for any connected graph have the same number of not vertices, edges. So, yeah, so let us try to understand this, and for this it is convenient to study circuits somewhat more carefully. So, what we are looking is avoiding circuits, right. So, so let us talk about circuits. So, so I will write down some properties of circuits, and we will, these are actually sort of, we can think of them as an axiomatic system. So, firstly, the empty, so we have some graph V comma E, and we are talking about the set of circuits in this graph. So, so firstly, the empty set, is that a circuit? It is a difficult question to answer, but what is the definition of a circuit? A definition of a circuit is that it is a sequence of vertices that start and end at the same place. So, if you were to literally take that, that means it has to start somewhere. So, it should have at least one vertex. I was a little careless while defining a circuit. Let us also think about some other cases. So, suppose I have, yeah, so what about this? Is this a circuit? V1, V2. So, I have V1, V2, V1. That is not a circuit, right? So let's go back and improve, write down. So this often happens while doing mathematics. You make a definition that's not too careful, and in college, of course, your teacher cuts points, but later on, you just get into trouble. So let's see. Circuits. So it's a sequence of distinct vertices. Should be more careful. Right. So, V1, V2, Vk have to be distinct, otherwise we can get something like, you know, V1 goes to V2 goes to V3 goes to V2 goes to V1. So, let us be a little more careful here. So, a circuit, if you are taking notes, you can make a correction to your notes. These lectures will be recorded and maybe I can also share notes. Okay. So you don't have to worry too much about taking notes. But if you are taking notes, make sure that you write a circuit is a sequence of distinct vertices. Otherwise, the definition is sort of not very useful. So we'll say that this empty set is a circuit. We'll all agree upon that. Here is the second property of circuits. If C1 and C2 are circuits and C1 is contained in C2, then what? So, I have some circuit V1, V2, V3, V4, oops. V1. Now, can you find another circuit that is contained in this? No, right? No proper subset is, right? So if I say if C1 is contained in C2, then C1 is equal to C2, right? Quite clear this thing. You can probably, you all agree that, I am not checking the messages, I keep forgetting. So, yes. Somebody has the right answer. Okay. So these are two very obvious properties of circuits. And there is a third very interesting property called circuit elimination.
I have a question.
Yeah.
So, if there is an edge between V2 and V4.
Yes.
So, then can you say that this one is subset of that circuit?
So, correct, but then what is the circuit C1?
The whole thing.
So, C1 is V1, V2, V3, V4. Okay, so that is a very good question, because again it seems like I have been a little. So, we are thinking of a subgraph and calling it a circuit. So when I say V1, V2, V3, V4 is a circuit, then I am only thinking of the edges. V1, V2, V2, V3, V3, V4 and V4, V1. Okay, so that means that V1, V2, V3, V4 is a circuit means that I am only looking at the edges of this circuit. I am not looking at this circuit inside some bigger graph. And so, then I cannot think of V2, V4 as an edge of. So, these are all subsets of edges. So I hope this is clear, but that is a very good question, because you know there is a potential for confusion here. Right? So, when I say circuit, I just mean a subset of edges which have the distinct vertices going round. And the third property is the most subtle one, and this is the circuit elimination property. And what this says is that if C1 and C2, I will just write it down first and then we will discuss it, are circuits, C1, not equal to C 2 and E belongs to C 1 intersect C 2. So, we are thinking of these just as sets of edges, right. So, when I am saying C 1, I am just thinking of a set of edges, C 2 another set of edges in some ambient graph V comma E. So, V comma E, C 1, C 2, these are subsets of E and there is some common edge in C 1 and C 2. Then you look at C 1 union C 2 minus E. So, let me just draw a picture to show you what is happening. So, the simplest possible picture I could draw is something like this. I have a circuit C 1, right. I have a circuit C 2. So, this is my circuit C 1, this is my circuit C 2 and this is an edge E. So, if I take C 1 union C 2 minus E, then in this case it is actually just a circuit, right. But it could be more complicated. Maybe I could have some, you know, let me draw some more complicated example. So, I have a bunch of, I have this circuit C 1 and I have a circuit C 2 which I will draw in some other color. So, let us see. So, I have my pink circuit C 2 and my blue circuit C 1 and they have an edge in common, right. So, for example, this edge here E is in common. So, now if you look at C 1 union C 2 minus E. So, I am looking at, I am just removing this edge, right. So, what I am doing is I am removing this edge E. Now, does this graph contain a circuit? For example, this is a circuit. There are many circuits, I think there are more than probably one, but here is a circuit, right. So, what this axiom says, this third rule, right now we are just calling it a rule. So, is that then C 1 union C 2 minus E contains a circuit. And the proof is actually not very hard, but I will not write down all the steps, but somehow the idea is that you have the two vertices at the two ends of this graph, they are connected via. So, now these two, remember these two circuits are not equal. So, there must be, you know, so they are connected via two distinct paths, one which is, so this C 1 was a circuit. So, even if I remove an edge, everything is connected because I go around the circuit in the other way, avoiding that edge. C 2 is also a circuit. Now, after removing this edge, I can go around it the other way, avoiding that edge. So, I get two paths from this point A to this point Z, right, one along C 1 and one along C 2. And it could be that those paths sort of, you know, run along together for some time, but there will be at least some place where they separate. And so, in this case, for example, here they separate and they join again. Finally, they have to join again because they have to reach Z. In this case, they actually separate and join again three times, but they will separate and join again at least once and that will give rise to a circuit. So, this is the circuit elimination property. So, what we can see is that whenever you have a graph, the set of circuits has these three properties. The empty set is a circuit. If one circuit is contained in another, then they have to be equal, and this circuit elimination property, which is the most subtle of the three. And using this, I can talk about what we wanted to do, which is looking at circuit free spanning trees rather, right, and say that they will all have the same size. So everybody is happy with these properties of circuits, if you feel something. So we will use these properties of circuits. Huh? The empty set is not a circuit. Oh my god, yeah, sorry, that is not correct. So a circuit has to have some vertices, okay, so some edges, because you, okay, so yeah, so this is essentially a matter of definition. So the empty set is not a circuit. See, when we want to say spanning tree, we want to talk about something that does not contain any circuits. So, if we take the empty set, that is a graph with no edges, as having a circuit, then we will never be able to find a graph which has no circuits, right. So we are saying that. So, when we talk about a graph not having circuits, we are saying that this graph has some edges, and when you remove some edges, the subgraph is a should not be a circuit, okay. So if we need the fact that the empty set is not a circuit. If the empty set were a circuit, then no graph would be circuit free, right, because just remove all the edges, and when we are saying, okay, that is a circuit. So the empty set should not be a circuit for any meaningful sort of for the definition to be useful at all. So we are talking about now circuit free graphs. So let us talk about circuit free graphs. Now, these circuit free graphs are going to be like in linear algebra, linearly independent sets, and the circuits are going to be sort of minimal linearly dependent sets. So, circuit free graphs. So, the first property of circuit free graphs is we want to think of the empty graph as circuit free. The second, suppose you have a graph that is circuit free and you remove some edges from it, then the resulting graph should still be circuit free, right. So, if E is circuit free and E prime is a subset of E, then E prime has to be circuit free. And finally, the third one is that, okay, so now we had that, you know, for the circuits we had three axioms, two were sort of easy, the third one was slightly more difficult. But here is the third axiom for circuit free graphs. If E, this is called the exchange condition. So, the cycle elimination, its analog is the exchange condition. So, it says that if E, E prime are both circuit free, and the cardinality of, maybe I should not call it E, E is my original graph. So, let us say E prime and E double prime are circuit free, and the cardinality of E prime is less than, strictly less than the cardinality of E double prime. Then you can find an edge in the bigger circuit free graph, which you can add to the smaller circuit free graph and still keep it circuit free. So, you may have seen this in linear algebra also, right. So, in if you when you want to prove that the dimension of a vector space is well defined, one way to do it is to say that suppose you have two linearly independent sets and one is larger than the other, then you can take a vector from the larger linearly independent set and add it to the smaller one, and the resulting set will still be linearly independent. So, this is the exchange condition in linear algebra, and now we are seeing that the same exchange condition also holds from for spanning trees, no, not for spanning tree, for circuit free subgraphs. So, so let us just so this actually implies that any two spanning trees have the same number of edges, right? Because if you have, what is a spanning tree? Well, we have seen in our analysis of the GRUE algorithm that a spanning tree is nothing but a circuit free subgraph to which you cannot add any more edges and still keep it circuit free. So, a spanning tree is a maximal circuit free subgraph, right. And so, now suppose you had two spanning trees of different cardinality, right. So, suppose I had, so corollary of this, any two spanning trees, not spanning trees, which are the same as maximal circuit free edge subgraphs have the same number of edges, because suppose I had, you know, if I have E prime and E double prime, these are two spanning trees, right, and they do not have the same number of edges. Then what I could do is, well, let us assume that say E prime has fewer edges than E double prime. Then if you were to believe this exchange condition, which I have not proved as yet, then what you would be able to do is remove one edge from E double prime and add it to E prime, right, such that E union E prime union E is circuit free, and that is a contradiction to the maximality of E prime. So, this exchange condition will imply that any two spanning trees have the same cardinality. Now, the proof of this exchange condition is just a graph theoretic proof I will give you. It is slightly, I mean it is a page long. So, let us just if you do not understand it the first time I explain, you can just try to look at it again and go over it. It is probably more complicated than the earlier proofs that I have given in today's lecture. So, do not feel, but let us try to follow. Okay. So, let us prove of the exchange condition, and what we will do is we will prove it from the properties of circuits. So, okay. So, suppose the exchange condition fails. Oops, I keep forgetting to look at the chat. So, so the first question, I think there are some interesting questions here. So, is it necessary that a circuit should have at least three vertices? And I think this is necessary because of the saying that there are distinct, the vertices v1, v2. Okay, so there are different sort of, so we are not allowing graphs with, the way I defined a graph, I said it's a set of vertices and a set of edges, and each edge is basically just the two vertices that it is connecting. So, I am not allowing implicitly, I am not allowing graphs with multiple edges. So, I am not allowing this situation where I have, you know, something like this. Otherwise, you could conceivably consider this to be a circuit in the graph, because even though the vertices are the same, the edges are not. So, the framework I am working in, I do not allow multiple edges, and I insist that every circuit have distinct vertices. Okay, so, going around something two times, I do not consider that to be a circuit either. So, it turns so with the definitions that I have given, a circuit must have at least 3 vertices. So, you do not have circuits with fewer than 3 vertices. And I think there was another comment, what if we consider only vertices without joining them by an edge? Can we say it is a graph? Yes, we can say it is a graph. We are thinking of a, so what we have in mind is some fixed graph V comma E, and we are looking at edge subgraphs of that. Okay, that is the setting we are working in. So, if you have no edges, that is also an edge subgraph, and that is certainly a circuit free subgraph, because a circuit must have at least 3 vertices by the definitions that we are using. Okay, so, yeah, there are, you know, you will find in many textbooks slightly different formulations of all this, where they allow graphs with loops and with multiple edges, and you can still do many of these things. In that case, a circuit would be a sequence of edges which are distinct and so on. So, you can modify these definitions to other settings. Okay, so now we come back to the sort of most what will end up being the most challenging part of this lecture, which is to derive the exchange condition from the circuit elimination condition. Well, actually we will use all 3 axioms for circuits. So, one thing I should say now at this stage is that I have taken this graph problem and sort of I have listed 3 properties of circuits, and what we are going to prove is 3 properties of circuit free edge subgraphs. So, there was a question, maybe I can't hear very well, so you could just type it in instead of unmuting. Okay, so that's the there are two different sets of axioms, and these axioms are actually axioms of what is called a matroid. Okay, so in mathematics there's a class of objects called matroids, and just like, you know, you have groups, rings, vector spaces, topological spaces and so on, a matroid is a set, and it has certain properties which are given by axioms. So, one way of formulating a matroid is to say that it is a set with a distinguished class of subsets called independent subsets, and they satisfy these axioms which we have for circuit free subgraphs. So, the empty set is independent if E is independent and E prime is a, maybe I should call this E prime and E double prime. Then a subset of an independent set is independent, and then this exchange condition. Another way to axiomatize matroids is using circuits. Using circuits. So, these axioms, and they turn out to give equivalent definitions for matroids. So, what is happening behind these scenes is really matroid theory, which unifies linear algebra and graph theory, and is actually a huge branch of mathematics in itself. So what we are going to do is we are going to essentially just use the axiomatics of circuits to prove the axioms for circuit free subgraphs. So, suppose that there exists, so I want to prove the exchange condition. So, what if the exchange condition fails? So, that means there exist cycle free circuit free subgraphs E1, E2 such that, let us say cardinality of E1 is less than cardinality of E2, but for every E in E 2, E 1 union E is not circuit free, right. Okay. So, this is what, and from this we will try to derive a contradiction, right. Then we would have proved the exchange condition. So, it is going to be a proof by contradiction. Okay. So, let us look at this graph E 1 union E 2. E 1 union E 2, well, so this is an edge graph whose edges are all the edges of E 1 and all the edges of E 2. And this certainly contains subgraphs that are circuit free, let us say circuit free subgraphs with let us say E 3 such that cardinality of E 1 is less than cardinality of E 3. Do you agree? Right. For example, it contains E 2, right. E 2 is a circuit free subgraph whose cardinality is greater than E 1. It is a strange statement to make. I could have just said E 2 is there, but it contains others perhaps. Okay. Now, what I want to do is, I will choose among all these E 3. So, there will be a bunch of them, but in a finite situation there will only be finitely many. So, choose among these E 3 such that the size of E 1 minus E 3 is minimal. Okay, so I have my subgraph, let us say E 1, edge free subgraph. I have my edge free, E 1 minus E 3. So, I will, E 1 is small, E 1 minus E 3 just means E 1 intersect E 3 complement. Okay, so, those edges in E 1 which are not in E 3, I am not saying that E 1 contains E 3. So, I have E 1 and I have E 3. As you can see in this Venn diagram, E 1 is not contained in E 3 and this E 1 minus E 3 is minimal. So, what that means is that if I take any edge in E 1 minus E 3 and add it to E 3, then that will have a cycle. That is all it means, right. Okay. So, okay. So, firstly, suppose E 1 minus E 3 is empty. What does that mean? That means that E 1 is contained in E 3. But E 3 has psi strictly greater than E 1, right. So, that means that I could have added an edge to E 1 while keeping it cycle free, but E 1, E 3 are both contained in E 1 union E 2. So, that edge must come from E 2. So, if then E 1 is contained in E 3, so there exists an edge E in E 2 such that E 1 union E is cycle free. So, this cannot happen, right. So, we cannot have that E 1 minus E 3 is empty. So, there must be at least one edge in E 1 that is not in E 3. So, we have at least this one edge here E that is in E 1 minus E 3. Okay. So, Okay. Now take any edge f in E3 minus E1. That must exist because E3 has cardinality strictly larger than the cardinality of E1. And let us look at the graph TF, which is you look at E3, you remove E, no, sorry, you E3 does not contain E, so we add E. Still not used to this E3 union E and remove F. Okay, so you take E3, add E and remove F. Now this is a subgraph, and if you look at this E1 minus TF, right? So this is a proper subset of E1 minus E3, because this edge E is in E1 minus E3, but it is not in E1 minus TF. Okay, so what that means is that this E1 minus TF must have a circuit, because we chose E3 to be minimal with the property that E1 minus E3. Minimizing E1 minus E3. So anything with smaller E1 minus E3, this still has the same number of elements, but it has a smaller E1 minus TF is smaller than E1 minus E3. So this has a circuit. So E1 minus TF has a circuit. No, not E1 minus TF, TF has a circuit. So TF has a circuit, and this circuit, so we are looking at TF, which is E3 union E minus F. So this circuit, it must contain the edge E, because E3 does not have any circuits, right? So if E3 union something as a circuit, then this circuit must have contain E. So we have this edge E, in fact, must be something like this, and there is some circuit inside this thing. So, and the circuit cannot have F in it, right? So there is some circuit, and let us call it CF. Whoops, has a circuit, let us call it CF. Okay. Now, we cannot have that CF cannot be contained in I1, right? Because in E1, there's some noise. So we cannot have that CF is contained in E1. So that means that there must be some point G in CF minus E1. Some edge. So we have this CF and E1, there must be some edge which is in CF but not in G1. So let us call that G. Okay, so now this situation with G is same as the situation with F. This G is an edge in E3 minus E1. So now what we can do is we can take TG equal to I3 union E minus G. This TG again contains a circuit. And this circuit again will have to contain E1. So this contains a circuit which I'll call CG, and E1 belongs to CG. So yeah, so we will have some other circuit here, let us put it in pink. It will not contain G, but it will also contain E, right. So we have these two circuits, yeah, E3, 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 Yeah, there's some noise in this speaker here, I guess, or I don't know where it is. Oh, is that right? Let me check. No, everybody is muted. Okay. So E1 belongs to CG. Okay, the noise seems to have stopped. Not E1, E belongs to CG. So this edge E is common in both CF and CG, right? So we have this situation of the circuit elimination axiom. We have two circuits CF and CG with a common edge E, right? And now we are done, because now if we look at CF union CG minus E, right? This is contained in entirely in E3, because E was the only thing which was not in E3, right? And this has a circuit by the circuit elimination property, which is a contradiction, because E3 has no circuits, right? And this is contained in E3. Okay, so this proof is, I must admit, it's slightly subtle. It took me like much longer than I spent explaining it to you. It took me longer than that to understand it. I had to go over it 2 or 3 times. So maybe, you know, it's worth thinking about a little bit. I'll share some references for matroid theory later. But you can also so what we see now, what we have proved in this lecture so far, is that all spanning trees have the same number of edges, right? So suppose you were the part of this telecom company which was laying the cables. However you did it, if you were to make sure that all the nodes were connected and that there were no cycles, then you would definitely end up with the same number of cables that had to be laid. Okay, and this is something that is akin to the idea in linear algebra, where you say that any two bases have the same cardinality. So let us see how we can think about this in terms of linear algebra. So what we will do is a common thing which I will do in this lectures is to do linear algebra. Yeah. Yeah.
So any two trees with the same number of vertices will always have the same number of edges.
Yes.
So if you take a spanning tree in a graph with the same number of vertices, that will have a same number of edges.
Yeah, that's true. So that is certainly true. So being connected, yeah. So maybe.
Or is it like the tree itself has been producing this matroid theory?
No. So your point is correct. I mean, so if you take any tree on n vertices, it will have certainly n minus 1 edges. How do you prove that? So if you have a spanning tree for any connected graph, it will also be a spanning tree for the complete graph.
Yes. No, sir. You go to the first example, sir. Yes. Go to the first example you are giving. You give that really.
Yeah. So this is the example. So suppose I added more edges and made it the complete graph.
Still the same.
It doesn't matter. I would still get a spanning tree for the complete graph.
Yes.
Right. So, but how do you? Okay. So you could try to show that all trees with the same number of vertices have the same number of edges. One way to do it is to use induction.
Yes.
On the number of vertices.
Correct.
So you can think of this as a different way to do it, which is somewhat more complicated. Okay. But
as a corollary of this, we can also prove
this implies that, but you're right, we sort of know how many
edges will be there for.
Yeah. Because a spanning tree for any connected graph will be a spanning tree for the complete graph. So it's just a spanning tree on that set of vertices. So they will have the same graph. So very good. I should have sort of pointed this out. But what we are doing here is we are proving it axiomatically. So maybe let me just state this more precisely. So maybe let's just give the definition of a matroid. So a matroid is a set. Yeah.
In this properties of cycloid graphs that you are defining, you probably assume that the subgraphs have to be connected.
The circuits are connected, right? Because
of the circuit free graphs.
Yeah, we don't need them to be connected. We can, so we can start with, you know, you can have one edge here, add an edge somewhere else, and then slowly build it without connectedness, and it will still work. So in some sense, we are not working with. So these are called forests. These are not trees. So we are not working with forests. We are not working with connected subgraphs. So you can just keep adding edges till it becomes connected. But it doesn't have to be connected at each stage. So the examples I did, I was doing it in some systematic manner, and somehow they always ended up being
stronger than the tree one,
right? Well, the point is at the end you always have a spanning tree. That's what we proved, right? And so from what he says, that if you have a tree with certain number of edges, vertices, then using induction, so you just delete one edge, a vertex from the tree, and you will only, one leaf actually from the tree, and you will only delete one edge. And so by induction, you can show that every tree has, every tree on n vertices has n minus 1 edges. So that's a perfectly valid proof. So what is a matroid? So a matroid is a set E together with a collection of subsets called independent sets. So a collection I of subsets such that one, the empty set is in I, two, if I1, I2 are in I and I1 is contained in I2, then there is not I1 is contained, sorry. The cardinality of I1. No, I1 is contained in I. Sorry, what I want to say is that a subset of an independent set is independent. I1, I2 in I, I1 contained in I2, then, no, what am I doing? I1 is in I1. Sorry, yeah, I2 is in I1 contained in I2, implies that I1 is in I, and the third is the exchange condition, I1, I2 belongs to I, cardinality of I1 less than cardinality of I2 implies that there exists E in I2. Such that in I2 minus I1, I1 union E belongs to I. So these are the independence axioms in a matroid, and there is an alternative definition of matroid which is called a circuit matroid. So okay, so so what we have shown, so there are two kinds of matroids which we have seen here. One is so this third property, of course, I don't think you can prove. So you can show that two spanning trees will have the same number of edges quite easily, but this third property, this exchange condition, is not so obvious for spanning trees. And so the proof I have given is still sort of needed for that, but to show that two spanning trees have the same cardinality is not so difficult, as you pointed out. So yeah, so this is the general definition of matroid, and what we have seen is two different examples. Today what we have seen is the matroid of spanning trees, and the other we will see is the matroid of independent sets. And what I am going to do maybe at the beginning of the next lecture is so there is one more comment here. Can we say that a spanning tree corresponding to n minus 1 edges must have n vertices? So a tree, it is always true that if you have a tree, the number of vertices is 1 more than the number of edges. And this is a nice exercise if you have not done it, prove it by induction on the number of vertices. So if the number of vertices is 1, then you have 0 edges. And now what you do is, suppose you have a tree, that means it is connected and it has no circuits, then with say n plus 1 vertices, then firstly so you need to show that there exists a vertex which has only one edge incident upon it. And then when you remove that vertex, you are removing one edge and one vertex, and you are getting another tree. So think about it, you can write down a proof without too much difficulty, that in a tree the number of edges is always the number of vertices minus 1. Okay. So okay, so let's, we'll try to relate these two things. Independent sets of vectors in a vector space, and spanning trees. And to do that, we'll use the field of two variables. So this is something that's common in all digital things, that we use the field F2. Field of two elements. So this field has two elements, 0 and 1. And of course, we know how to add them, multiply them, subtract them, and everything has an inverse. So 0 plus 1 is 1, 0 plus 0 is 0, 1 plus 1 is 0, right. So integers mod 2, and then you can multiply them, 1 into 1 is 1, 1 into 0 is 0, 0 into 0 is 0, and the inverse of 1 is 1, 0 does not have an inverse, as it does not in any other field. So this is a field. And when we do linear algebra, we talk about a vector space over a field. So usually when we learn linear algebra geometrically, it is nice to think about the field as the real numbers, and then three-dimensional vector space is just like the physical world, and maybe four-dimensional is like space-time or something, and then five-dimensional is very difficult to even imagine, but you can have some geometric intuition about it. And we will try to relate these things to, we will do linear algebra over the field with two elements. So there is a lot of nice simplifications about the field with two elements. For example, suppose we say that V1, V2, V3 are linearly dependent. So suppose V is a vector space over F2, okay. And suppose I want to say that let us just say V1 and V2 are linearly dependent. So, let us say when you know V is finite dimensional. So, maybe I can even assume that V is equal to F2 to the n. So, this V1 is just a sequence of zeros and ones, V2 is again a you know a tuple ordered sequence of zeros and ones. What does it mean to say that V1 and V2 are linearly dependent? Just means that either V1 is equal to V2 or one of them is 0, right. But there is another way of talking about linear relations, which is to say that there are scalars A1 and A2 such that A1 V1 plus A2 V2 is equal to 0, right. So, now these are scalars, they have to be 0 or 1. So, what we are saying is they are linearly dependent means that either V1 is 0 or V2 is 0 or both V1 and V2 are 0, not V1 is 0, sorry. A1 is 0, yeah, in which case sorry A1 is 0, which means that we are saying that V2 is 0, right. A2 is 0, which means that we are saying that V1 is 0, or we could say that neither of them is 0, but which means both of them are 1, right. So, which means that V1 plus V2 is 0. If both of them are 1, which means V1 is equal to V2. Okay. Now, in general, if we have vectors V1, V2, Vm and we are saying they are linearly dependent, what does this mean? So, this choice of scalars are just 0 and 1. So, it means that some subset of them add up to 0, right. So, are linearly dependent over F2 if and only if, right, there exists some subset I1 less than I2 less than IK and K has to be greater than or equal to 1 such that VI1 plus VIK is equal to 0. Right. So, somehow this linear dependency over the field F2 becomes a very set theoretic thing. We are just saying that there is some subset that becomes 0. Okay, so, when we are looking about talking about edge subgraphs and so on, again we are looking at subsets of edges. So, linear algebra over F2 becomes almost like linear dependence and so on becomes almost like set theoretic. So, what I will do is in the next lecture, I am going to take the same problem of spanning trees and I am going to show you how to formulate it as a problem in linear algebra. So, whatever we prove about bases in linear algebra will then translate into the corresponding result for spanning trees. So, when you prove these axioms of independent sets for linear algebra, these rules of independent sets that a subset of a set of linearly independent vectors linearly independent and you have two sets of linearly independent vectors and one is cardinality larger than the other, then you can move a vector from the larger one to the smaller one and keep it linearly independent. So, those will imply actually what we proved today using graph theory. So, that's what I'm going to do next time, and so we can stop here and take a short break, and of course if you have any questions you can feel free to ask, and I'll send you some assignments, some problems to solve.